the opening ceremonies from the Beijing Summer Games. Here's ABC's David Muir.
This was the moment China had long hoped for. Fireworks that formed the Olympic rings in the Beijing sky. Inside the stadium, a mesmerized crowd, 90,000 people watching stunning acrobatics and costume changes celebrating 5,000 years of Chinese history. President Bush and the First Lady on their feet as the American flag bearer made his way into the stadium. Runner Lopez Lemong, once a refugee of war in Sudan. With him, the 600-strong U.S. team. The only delegation larger, China's 639 members. Native son Yao Ming held China's flag and a little boy's hand, a 9-year-old schoolboy who survived May's earthquake. Finally, a Chinese gymnast suspended in midair lit the torch.
This is a moment China has coveted. They aggressively courted these Olympics for years. Along with the fireworks here, the deafening sounds of the military helicopters, desperate to protect these games.
Throughout the day, an already vigilant Beijing was even more so. As we drove past Tiananmen Square today, not a soul, closed off by guards who were posted on street corners throughout the city. The officers far outnumbered the lone protesters, three Americans demonstrating to free Tibet. Later, in this Beijing park, the opening ceremonies played out on TV screens before thousands. This journalist told us, "I'm so moved and proud tonight to see my country put on such an Olympics. Proud because he knows the world is watching." David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
Reporting tonight from Beijing, David Muir.
Good evening from China, where you can see the haze hovering over the Bird's Nest Stadium here behind me. It is early morning here, and the cheer on Team USA as well, and an early U.S. sweep of the first women's fencing competition actually gave the U.S. the lead in the medal count after the first full day of the games here. Well, far apart from the pageantry of the Olympic Games, to the west of here, a much different picture. In fact, we learned today that the ground shook once again in Sichuan Province. That, of course, is the region of this country where a massive earthquake killed 69,000 last May. This time, the tremor 4.3 on the Richter scale. It's the third aftershock just this week. We traveled back to Sichuan Province and found a region still in ruin. This is the China not seen with the world spotlight now shining on Beijing. As we traveled through Sichuan province, the roads were lined with stacks of bricks and wire, precious resources salvaged by townspeople still digging through the rubble 3 months later. A tractor sits where houses once stood, ready to pull out what little they can save. This woman carries a basket on her back, anything to carry materials they can use to rebuild. This man points to the pile that was once his home, still proudly wearing his Olympics t-shirt. But there is still so much anger here. Parents who have demanded answers from the Chinese government. How could the schools have so easily crumbled? I work 6 days a week looking for bricks, this woman told us. She then goes back to temporary housing and watches the Olympics. It is her escape. Survivors lifted their glasses, toasting one another last night as they watched the opening ceremonies. They lit candles and laid them out in the shape of the five Olympic rings. With the world focused on the images coming out of the Beijing Games, here, 1,200 miles southwest of Beijing, there is another American team still focused on something else. Wisconsin native Dee Galuba has set up this makeshift warehouse in Chengdu.
These are the kits all here.
These are the kits, exactly. They're lining up in the walls, and they've lined up some rooms down this hallway and down that hallway.
Aid workers and volunteers work tirelessly filling hygiene kits, delivering them to temporary schools. They say it's easier to give them to the children. Volunteers here, now in their third month, hope it's these faces the world will remember, with so many lenses now focused elsewhere. The picture tonight outside the Olympic spotlight. And we took note of a moment between President Bush and members of the U.S. women's beach volleyball team. Misty May Treanor gave the president a chance to give her a pat of encouragement, traditional in volleyball, on her behind. The president looked at her, decided to pat her on the back instead. And finally tonight here, the American mom feeling the weight of the world watching her, and she welcomes it. Melanie Roach of Washington State competes here tomorrow, and who's lifting her up? Take a look.
Control.
At just 5'1 and 117 pounds, it's hard to picture this petite mother from outside Tacoma, Washington, as an Olympic weightlifter.
Okay, Drew, say my turn.
She's also the mother of three young children, a politician's wife, and a business owner. And she means business here in Beijing. She plans to break a record.
250 pounds on these shoulders.
Yeah.
This is her first Olympics.
Do people look at you and see you on the team and say, wait a minute, you're so tiny?
You know, no one has accurately guessed my sport. First thing they say is, are you a gymnast or a soccer player? You know, they never guess weightlifting.
She's perfectly content breaking the mold here. She's the only mother of three on the team, a role she cherishes even more than the one here in Beijing. In fact, she says the hardest part about being here so far are the 2 weeks she's already been away from her children. Her son, Drew, is autistic, and she says he is a big reason why she's here. The lessons learned when motherhood threw her a curve. Her husband is now here to watch her compete. But as she learned on the phone while we were with her, security is so tight here, she'll have to wait a little longer before she gets to see him.
Okay.
Back home, the rest of her family and a whole slew of friends and fans will be in front of their TVs tomorrow night, little Drew among them.
Drew will be rooting on his mom, and so will we. That is world news for this Saturday night. I'm David Muir here in Beijing.
He's David Muir, joins us now from Beijing. David?
Jim, good evening to you. As you know, these Olympics have been politicized even before they began here in China. With the world watching this country, its record on human rights, the pollution, promises to clean it up, among other things. But that focus has shifted dramatically, at least for a moment, given this crisis between Russia and neighboring Georgia.
It was an extraordinary image of unity. Two Olympic athletes, a Georgian embracing her Russian rival, after the two won the bronze and silver respectively in a shooting competition. The moment came after the Georgian team offered to quit the games over the conflict with Russia. The Georgian president told them to stay and compete. On this day after the random attack on two Americans here, another powerful image. The U.S. men's volleyball team won their game, a preliminary round, without their coach. Hugh McCutcheon was instead at a Chinese hospital as his mother-in-law underwent 8 hours of surgery after surviving a knife attack. Her husband died in the attack, casting a dark shadow on this first weekend of the games. President Bush, meanwhile, spent part of his day in the stands, cheering on American swimmer Michael Phelps, who took his first gold, breaking his record in the 400-meter individual medley.
New world record!
Phelps called the thumbs up from the president pretty cool. Michael Phelps shared the spotlight here. Swimmer Dara Torres became the oldest athlete to win an Olympic swimming medal.
Wow, she did a great job.
A silver in the relay. The 41-year-old mother said afterward, the water doesn't really know what age you are.
And Dara, of course, will compete again later this week. It is morning here in Beijing, and one of the big headlines here, of course, the big U.S. win over China in basketball. The final 101-70, it was a blowout. The medal count as it stands right now, the top three countries, of course, U.S., China, and South Korea. But we should point out that China leads in the gold, having won 6 gold so far to the U.S. 2. Jim?
So, David, not the closest game in basketball between the U.S. and China, but how does it play into that intensifying rivalry between the two countries?
I think this actually plays right into that rivalry, in fact. China's been working so hard, as you know, Jim. It begins training and pursuing its athletes at a very young age, sometimes picking the sport for them. They were second to the U.S. in Athens the last go-round. They want to flip that now with the Olympic spotlight right here on China.
Well, it's going to be a long run to the finish. David Muir in Beijing this evening. Thank you.
David Muir is in Beijing.
His fists pumping the air, Michael Phelps couldn't contain his smile. His teammates had just helped keep his quest for 8 gold medals alive. Those hopes appeared to be dashed as the French team in the 4x100 relay pulled ahead. The same team that said it would vanquish the American team, and they were about to. Until the fourth American swimmer, Jason Lezak, came from half a length behind and out-touched his French opponent, winning by 0.08 seconds. Few hearts could have been beating faster than Phelps, except perhaps Phelps's mother.
Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God.
And your heart hasn't stopped.
No. I mean, that was nerve-wracking.
Her son now has 2 golds here in his race to beat Mark Spitz's record of 7. Colin Jones, who's on the relay team, knew just how much was on the line. After the race, Phelps's teammates said he need not thank them. They all know of his extraordinary journey. The son raised by a single mom, who teachers said would never amount to much, diagnosed with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Who knew those same limbs would become his secret weapon?
You need this for your living room wall or something.
Oh, that would be it right there.
Phelps's mom is no longer his only champion.
China is falling in love with him. The world now knows his name.
Not long after the relay, Michael Phelps set another Olympics record in one of his qualifying rounds, which simply means he's now ready to compete for his next gold. David Muir, ABC News, outside the Water Cube in Beijing.
He's David Muir reports on Elizabeth Callahan taking a shot at a medal.
To her teammates, she's known simply as Libby, the 56-year-old straight shooter from South Carolina who loves baking, gardening, and pulling the trigger. She had no idea of her talents until she joined the Washington, D.C. police force in 1975, when women were far outnumbered by the men. When those men first saw her at the range, they knew she had something. And so she did, winning her first match.
You were beating the men.
A lot of times I was.
She hasn't stopped since. Just where did her talent come from? Libby says she had a lot of practice competing, growing up as one of eight. All of those brothers kept her on her game.
What do those little brothers think now, all these years later?
They're proud of me.
And they have plenty of reason to be. This is the fourth Olympics she's qualified for, but she's still trying for that medal on a team with many athletes in their 20s.
What do you make of these 20-year-olds on the team?
Well, I think it's great.
Because it really doesn't faze Libby. She's already looking forward, but don't be fooled. She's focusing her aim on tomorrow, when the woman who once turned heads on the D.C. police force back in the 70s hopes to do it again, this time with the world watching. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
The U.S. leads the Olympics medal count with 29, 10 of them gold. Half those golds were for events featuring Michael Phelps, the swimming sensation who has now won more gold medals than any Olympic athlete ever. When you see him in the water, he looks like no other swimmer we've ever seen. As David Muir reports from Beijing, your eyes do not deceive you.
After winning his latest gold, one of Michael Phelps' Russian rivals said, "He may be human, but he must be from a different planet." He was joking, sort of, because here, even among the world's most elite swimmers, Phelps' talent mystifies. How does he do it?
He has great feeling of the water.
Gennadius Sokolovas is the director of sports science for the U.S. swimming team. He has studied every part of Phelps' technique. The stroke, powered by an enormous wingspan, 6 feet, 7 inches across. That's 3 inches farther across than he is tall. But even more than his stroke, Sokolovas says, is Phelps' kick. He can bend his size 14 feet, 15 degrees beyond the average, essentially turning his legs and his extended feet into giant flippers. And what fuels him? It takes a lot to feed this fish. 10 to 12,000. The average man might need 2,000 calories a day. This whole fascination with Michael Phelps and his incredible skill level is no longer just an American one. The world is watching. And here, where the China-U.S. rivalry is intensifying, even the Chinese are marveling at what this American swimmer can do.
Are you cheering on Michael Phelps?
Of course.
Yes.
He's going for 8 golds, this girl told me, and I support him. There has been some grumbling here that technology, Phelps' new Speedo, might be helping. But the other teams have similar suits, too. And so far, it's Michael Phelps, the 23-year-old American who's proving to the world he's made for the water. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
But you can't talk about gold at these games without talking about Michael Phelps. 5 down, 3 to go in his quest for an unprecedented 8 gold medals. Phelps is trying to break the record of Mark Spitz. And what does Spitz think of all this? David Muir reports from Beijing.
It was 36 years ago Mark Spitz dove into the record books in Munich.
Here comes Spitz.
Winning 7 gold medals, the most ever in a single Olympic game. A record he's held ever since. And it's a record that is now within Michael Phelps' grasp. At 58 years old, Spitz remembers well what it was like and says he can imagine what's racing through Phelps' mind. Married for 35 years, Spitz has 2 sons, both athletes, cheering on one in basketball, the other in golf. And now he's cheering on Phelps. He has spoken often with Michael Phelps, whose Olympic personality is a bit different from Spitz 3 decades ago. Phelps is beloved by his teammates. Just this week, they said no thank you was needed when they helped Phelps win the relay to keep his golden dreams alive. Spitz's competitive nature often turned his teammates off. But Spitz would parlay that competitive spirit into entrepreneurial success over the 30 years, his latest venture, working as a pitchman with fellow Olympic legend Nadia Comaneci. But it seems he's pitching for someone else now.
As Michael Phelps competes here at the Water Cube behind me, Mark Spitz says he'll be at a hotel in Detroit watching 2 events, the swimming and his son's basketball.
And even Mark Spitz believes that someone is Michael Phelps. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
David Muir.
The matchup was extraordinary. Two beloved American gymnasts, two friends, both cheering the other on. Shawn Johnson, the world champion from Des Moines, and Nastia Lukin, the daughter of an Olympic gymnast from outside Dallas. Here in Beijing, they are roommates. They began with the vault. Johnson excelled. So did Lukin.
Wow!
Then the balance beam, and Lukin begins to shine.
Wow!
With Lukin ahead by just a sixth of a point, they head into the floor exercise, where Johnson is known to excel. And Lukin is up first.
And absolutely perfect. Shawn Johnson is coming onto the floor, and they do a little hand slap, the two of them. How often do you see that?
Johnson, that feisty fireplug of an athlete, delivers two, no mistakes. And then they wait for the score. From Johnson, a wave to Mary Lou Retton. Lukin huddles with her dad, the former Olympian, now her coach. It was Nastia Lukin by 6/10 of a point, her eyes welling up as she held the gold.
With the Chinese women having already won the gold this week in the team event, with so many questions about their true age, Nastia Lukin and Shawn Johnson were not only competing against one another, it seemed they were competing together against China.
Lukin's victory was also sweet for one more reason. 20 years ago, her father lost the gold to a fellow Soviet in the same competition. Two decades later, his daughter was sharing hers. Her father said afterward, "She fixed my mistake. I'm proud," he said. Too emotional to continue. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
Survival story. The giant pandas, whose half-million-acre habitat was rocked by that earthquake that hit central China just months before the Olympics. ABC's David Muir reports from the pandas' new home tonight in China.
When the ground began to rumble and the mountainside gave way here in Sichuan province last May, China's national treasure was in peril at the foot of the mountain. The walls around this panda sanctuary had collapsed. Dozens of frightened pandas escaped. Caretakers gave us these images taken in the hours after the earthquake. Rescuers tried to pry the bears out of trees and down branches. Many of them had climbed to the highest point they could find. This group huddled atop what was left of its playground. Another bear clutched to the top of what was left of this tree. There are only 1,600 pandas left in China, and the only group more frightened than the bears were the caretakers themselves. Professor Huan Yan helps run the center. After the earthquake, he told us, six ran away. Their walls had collapsed. Some of them did not return. The pandas they did find had to be carried out of the woods on tarps and then put in cages. They were taken to another reserve hundreds of miles away. Traveling on crumbled roads, it took 3 days to get them there. We traveled to that panda sanctuary to check on the bears. The cubs are kept in a separate building. Few people are allowed in. They invited us to see them, asking us to put on plastic gloves and booties first. They are determined to keep these cubs healthy. Inside, a half dozen pandas, eager to see their American visitors. Their trauma has slowly been erased. After rescuing many of these cubs from the trees and then bringing them here, you can see they're doing extraordinarily well, even in the 3 months since the earthquake. Olympic gold here, hundreds of miles west of Beijing, comes in the form of newborn pandas. There are now nearly a dozen since the earthquake, two more since the Olympics began. This one was just 5 days old. China's prized pandas, now saved. David Muir, ABC News, Yan'an, China.
David Muir has more now from Beijing.
Good evening, Dan. You know, after winning that eighth gold medal, Michael Phelps said this was one of the greatest weeks of his life, if not the greatest ever. You know, here in China, where eight is considered lucky, they began these games on 8-0-8-0-8. Phelps said today, he now believes eight's lucky too.
It was one last dive into the record books here in Beijing. Michael Phelps winning a record 8 gold medals in just one Olympic Games. Hugging his mother in the stands, his champion, once told by teachers not to expect much from her son. Today, Phelps described that moment with his mom.
She just said congratulations, and then she started crying, and then I started crying, and then my sister started crying.
Phelps also spoke of the close calls here, winning the butterfly by 1/100th of a second. That first relay, the American team trailing until the very end. There was the encouragement from another American swimmer, another star, the 41-year-old mom from California, Dara Torres.
Ah, unbelievable. He just did an amazing job, and it's just, I can't even imagine anyone doing that again.
It's going to be tough to repeat what Torres has done here as well. At 41, she's won 3 silver medals here, the oldest American swimmer at the Olympics. She missed out on gold in one race by 1/100th of a second.
So close.
Somebody told me that you were looking at Michael Phelps' race when he won by 1/100th of a second.
And I remember watching.
She is still enormously proud of herself and of Phelps, who she now predicts will be flooded with endorsement deals. But today, Michael Phelps wasn't going there, instead concentrating on his team.
And while he wasn't talking today about the money to be made, Michael Phelps was still talking numbers. He brought up that 200-meter butterfly, that race that was so close. He said he thinks he could have gone faster. Dan?
David Muir, thank you.
He's David Muir.
Two Americans who have redefined their sport, Michael Phelps winning more gold than any Olympian ever, and the swimmer Phelps affectionately calls mom, Dara Torres, the 41-year-old who won 3 silver medals here, the oldest woman ever to swim at the Olympics. Today, Michael Phelps said he's looking forward to 2012, new races and new records he'd like to set. And with the world now watching, Phelps also says he'd like to share the spotlight with his sport.
After finishing here, Michael Phelps says he's been overwhelmed with the text messages, the emails, the phone call from President Bush telling Phelps to hug his mom.
And as for that race he won by 1/100th of a second, this is what his teammate said right after.
You have to have angels with you or something. He goes, I have no idea what it is.
Dara Torres told us she was watching Phelps the entire way. You can imagine doing what Torres has done either. She competed in her first Olympics at 17. 24 years and 12 medals later, she's still breaking barriers. And right by her side, even during our interview, the mom who first brought her to that pool at age 7.
When I swam my first meet on this comeback, she said to me, I cannot believe that I'm at a swim meet again. So I'm sure she can't believe that she's at another Olympic Games again.
For Torres, tonight it's back home to California to drive her own daughter to school Wednesday morning. As for her son, as she calls him, Michael Phelps, she can't wait to see what he's achieved by the time he's 41. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
David Muir has her story.
Here in Beijing, Gao Jun is a hero of sorts, signing autographs for her Chinese fans. She began playing ping pong here when she was just 5. And in China, where they aggressively scout young talent, the little girl with a penchant for ping pong was spotted early. At 17, she made the national team and soon competed at the Olympics.
My first Olympic was in 1992 in Barcelona. I was playing for China.
You played for the Chinese team?
Yeah.
Your next Olympics?
2000, I played for U.S.
That's right, the U.S. team. Gao married an American and moved to the States after retiring from the Chinese team. At 25, she was considered old in her homeland for her sport.
On the American team, where do you rank?
I guess I'm ranked number 1.
At 39, she's now back in China, and it's ping pong that brought her here.
After all, it was ping pong that brought the U.S. and China together for the first time after communism took hold here. In 1971, a team of American ping pong players was invited to visit China, the Great Wall. At the time, one writer said it was the ping heard round the world.
Not long after, President Nixon came to visit, and all these years later, China is opening its doors again, even to athletes like Gao, who are now competing against China. But don't be mistaken, the battle lines have been drawn.
So China wants to beat you.
Oh yeah, I want to beat them too.
Gao admits beating the Chinese in ping pong will be tough, and she would know. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
This is David Muir on what makes Bolt the fastest man on earth.
It was hard to believe what we were seeing, that enormous gap between Jamaica's Usain Bolt and so many world-class runners so far behind him. As Bolt shattered his second world record and earned a second gold medal, the pictures said it all. Against the fastest men in the world, Bolt is in a league all his own.
But just what is it physically that sets Bolt so far ahead of the pack, 25 feet ahead at the end of last night's race?
We compared Bolt's height to the competition. Take the 100 meters. The last five gold medalists were on average 6 feet tall. Bolt is 6'5". And for most, a towering frame means a slower start, but not Bolt. And then that same towering frame with those impossibly long legs becomes impossible to beat. The other runners took an average of 47 steps to the finish line. That's 6.9 feet per stride. Bolt took just 41 steps, 8 feet per stride. Bolt is sweeping past not only the runners in his field, but history. It was just 1996 when American Michael Johnson ran the 200 in 19.32 seconds. At the time, analysts thought that record would last for the ages, like Mark Spitz's record, 7 golds, 36 years before Michael Phelps came along. But Bolt is already here. After last night's awe-inspiring victory, Michael Johnson called Bolt Superman 2. And he's super young. Bolt turned just 22 today. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
He's David Muir is in Beijing.
Henry Cejudo has done it. He has won the gold.
Henry Cejudo wrapped himself in the American flag, tossed from the stands by his family. Overcome with emotion, Henry is the youngest American wrestler to ever win gold. And that's the least of it. Henry is the son of illegal immigrants from Mexico. His mother raised 7 children on her own, working 2, sometimes 3 jobs a day. His father left when he was just 4. Henry's family moved from L.A. to Albuquerque to Phoenix. The one constant for him, joining the school wrestling teams. And it was in Phoenix that the scrappy 121-pound wrestler made an enormous impression on his new coach.
I would say he's the most driven person I've ever seen.
Coach Tracy Grief calls himself Henry's helper, but Henry sometimes calls him something else, Dad.
In 7th grade, he told you I'm gonna win the gold.
But Henry's biggest fan, his mother, was watching from back home in the States. He's already promised her he'll share that gold medal with her. She just might have to pry it off.
Have you taken this off yet?
I slept with it last night.
You did?
Yeah.
His medal is now a magnet of sorts. Even the Chinese are enamored with this 5'5 wrestler with the beaming smile. The thing is, Hollywood couldn't script a story like this, and it's still being written. Henry's coaches say this wrestler isn't finished yet. Not even close. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.
Tonight during the closing ceremonies at the Olympics, it appears China quietly deported 8 Americans it had jailed for protesting in Beijing. ABC's David Muir is in Beijing.
The closing ceremonies were another dazzling display as China's moment in the world spotlight comes to a close. But even the fireworks couldn't blur China's still unanswered record on human rights. Foreign activists were jailed for protesting here, and designated protest zones stayed empty because China refused to issue permits, even arresting some who applied for them. But China could not control all.
There is an asterisk, and it's hanging there, and that this doubt about the Chinese gymnasts, it's casting still a pall over the reputation of these games.
Just how old were those Chinese gymnasts and their gold medalist, He Kexin? Even reports in government newspapers once showed she was 14, not 16. But other dramatic feats here shifted the focus. Michael Phelps winning more gold than any Olympic athlete in history.
That scream was the scream that I think is probably the biggest visual of these Olympic games.
Few could have imagined a storyline as compelling, as exciting as Michael Phelps. And then it came right here at the Bird's Nest as lightning struck twice. That lightning came from the chest-thumping Jamaican Usain Bolt. And there was America's 1-2 punch. Gymnasts Nastia Lukin and Sean Johnson, dear friends, roommates, and rivals too. Bolt left with gold here and unmatched grace. In the end, China won more gold than any other country. But whether that gold can erase so many lingering doubts is a feat left unfinished. David Muir, ABC News, Beijing.